In the last video, we talked about how to take adjoints in Rn or Cn with the standard inner product, and it boiled down to just taking the transpose or the transpose conjugate of a matrix. Now we're going to talk about what happens if we're in another vector space, or maybe Rn or Cn with a non-standard inner product. So here's the big deal. If you have a finite dimensional vector space and you have an orthonormal basis, not just an orthogonal basis, we want it to be orthonormal. And if we have an operator, then, first of all, the adjoint always exists. And secondly, the matrix of the adjoint, relative to this basis, is the transpose conjugate of the matrix of the original operator, relative to this basis. Okay? So the idea is that whenever you take coordinates, you make a vector space look like Rn or Cn. Using an orthonormal basis makes it look like Cn with a standard inner product. On Cn, you know how to do adjoints. They always exist, and you can get them by taking transpose conjugate. So that means that on a vector space, adjoints always exist, and you take the transpose conjugate not of the operator itself, because the operator itself might be derivatives on the space of functions, or Lord knows what else, but you can take the transpose conjugate of the matrix of the linear transformation, and that will be the matrix of the adjoint. So that's the idea. Let's make that more precise. If you want to figure out the matrix of the adjoint, the ij entry of the adjoint, we've seen how to figure out the ij entry of any operator with respect to an orthonormal basis. You compute the matrix elements. You apply the operator to bj, and you take the inner product of bi with that. That'll always give you the ij entry. Now, if you switch the order of the two things that you're taking inner products of, that results in taking the conjugate of the quantity. This is the symmetry property of inner products. You take the inner product of y with x, that's the conjugate of the inner product of x with y. And then you say, oh yeah, L dagger on the left, that's the same thing as L on the right. And L on the right applied to bi, inner product with bj, well, that's just the ji matrix element. So the ij matrix element of L dagger with respect to the b basis is the conjugate of the ji matrix element of L with respect to the b basis. In other words, the matrix of L dagger is the transpose conjugate of the matrix of L. And you can also express the operator L dagger itself in terms of bras and kets. If you know the matrix elements, you know the operator. You take the matrix elements times the outer product of bi with bj. So you can always write L dagger as this sum, or you can write it this way, because L dagger bij is lbi dot into bj. Okay. So that means that if you have two vectors, which you expand with respect to these bases, you can check that if you apply this operator to x and then take the inner product of y, or if you apply L to y and take the inner product of x with that, that you get the same things. And it's always going to be the sum of xi bar, lij, xj, yj. This is a yj, not an xj. Okay. Now, I'm not going to go through the computation. It's a little bit tedious, but it's totally mechanical and not hard. The last topic for this video has to do with adjoints in a totally different space, not a finite dimensional space where you have an orthonormal basis, but an infinite dimensional space, namely L2 of the real line. So these are functions on the real line where we take the inner product of two functions is defined to be the integral of the first times the second, first conjugated, and we're integrating from minus infinity to infinity. And our operator that we want to look at is just the derivative operator. And I claim that the adjoint of the derivative operator is minus the derivative operator. And the way to see that is integration by parts. See, f operator acting on g, by definition, that's the integral of f bar times the derivative of g dt. But if you integrate by parts, that tells you that it's f bar times g at the endpoints minus the integral of f bar prime g dt. Now, f and g are both square integrable, which means they have to die as you approach infinity. So the limit as you go to infinity or minus infinity of this product is zero. You get nothing from the boundary term. And you're left with minus the inner product of f prime with g. In other words, minus a derivative applied to f gives you the same effect as a derivative applied to g. And in fact, this comes up a lot in quantum mechanics. In quantum mechanics, we often work with, we call our variable x instead of t. And the momentum operator is minus I times Planck's constant times the derivative with respect to x. And the adjoint of that operator, we have to take the conjugate of minus I h bar times the conjugate of d by dx. And that's plus I h bar times minus d by dx. So that's minus I h bar d by dx is p itself. The momentum operator has a property that when you conjugate it, you get the same thing back again. This is an example of what's called a Hermitian operator. Most important quantities in quantum mechanics are expressed by Hermitian operators, and we're going to talk more about Hermitian operators in the next video.